So whenever we are doing a project, Six Sigma project, then we need to define the metrics. So we categorize them into primary project metrics and secondary project metrics. So the primary project metrics are the metrics which are needed to ensure that the requirements of the project are measurable and therefore controlled during the project. So whenever we are doing the project, so then what are the main measurable parameters that needs to be controlled? So the first one is the cost. So we cannot, we have a budget for any project and then there cannot be any overrun of the cost. Same way we are going to have a firm schedule, so there should not be any time overrun may be there. The scope has to be managed. So the quality has to be taken care, the defectives and the defective parts has to be minimized. So these are all some of the metrics which needs to be measured and controlled during the any of the projects. So these primary metrics are developed in the defined phase of the project, but they are not finalized until the measured phase. So the primary metrics for consideration of a project can come from various sources like the suppliers or from the internal processes or from the customers. So some of the examples of the primary metrics for the projects are like quality, cycle time, cost, value, etc. So the primary metrics are very, very important for a primary, for the project, so that these primary metrics needs to be controlled. Then we talk about the secondary project metrics. So the secondary metrics for the projects are derived from the primary metrics. So in the primary metrics, maybe we might have identified that quality is a problem. So how we are going to measure quality for your particular project, again, we may not be very clear. So the secondary metrics will help you to identify how you are going to measure the quality, right? So the secondary metrics are normally the numerical representations of the primary metrics. So that means if quality is identified as a primary metric, then how the quality can be measured in terms of numbers, so that we will be able to identify what is the current baseline and what is the target we want to achieve. So some of the examples of secondary metrics include, say, defects per unit or DPU, defects per million opportunities, that is DPMO, then average duration of deliverables, line of error-free software codes, scrap percentage. So these are all some of the examples of secondary metrics. So once you have a primary metric like quality, then you will be able to define the secondary metric as a DPU or DPO or scrap percentage, etc. And then whenever you are talking about the schedule, then maybe the cycle time can be defined as a one of the key secondary project metric. So here we need to understand some of the very important concepts of definitions of DPU and DPMO. So here the unit is the event or transaction produced or processed. Say for example, you assume that on a particular day 100 insurance policies are being processed. Okay, 100 insurance policies are being produced in an insurance company. So the number of units produced are, we call that as U. So U is equal to 100. So this 100 is the total, the events or transactions produced or processed. We call that as U. And then the number of defective policies with units whatever they are produced. So number of defective units whatever you are producing, we call that as D. Say, assume that on a particular day, you have produced 5 defective insurance policies. So in that case, D is equal to 5. So now, the opportunity is, in what are the different ways in which the particular unit can go wrong? So a policy can go wrong because of so many reasons. Say, for example, a policy can be considered as defective if there are any spell errors are there, then there is an error in the name of the person on which on whom the insurance was issued, then on the amount of insurance, so there may be a problem in the amount. So like that, we can see what are the different ways in which the insurance policies can go wrong. So in this case, suppose you assume that these are the three different ways, in some way it may be the address may be wrong, in some way it may be the telephone number. So in this example, there are five different ways in which a insurance policy can go wrong. So in that case, we called O as equal to 5. So O is equal to the number of opportunities or number of ways in which a particular product can go wrong. Then using these values of U, D and O, you will be able to calculate the DPU and DPMO. So now we are having this slide in front of you. So again, in the last slide, we have seen how we are going to define this. We had some example where U was equal to 100, D is equal to 5 and O is equal to 5. Now, how do you calculate the DPU? DPU is equal to D divided by U, where D is the total number of defects and U is the total number of units. So in this case, it is D is 5 and U is 100. So DPU is equal to 5 by 100, that is equal to 0.05. Then how do you calculate the DPO? DPO is equal to D by U into O, where D is the total number of defects, U is equal to total number of units, and O is the opportunities for defects per unit. So we have found that D is equal to 5, U is equal to 100, and O is equal to 5. So DPO is equal to 5 divided by 5 into 100. That is equal to 0.01. Then how do you calculate DPMO? DPMO is equal to 1 million into DPO. DPMO is equal to DPO into 1 million. That is equal to 0.01 into 1 million. That is equal to 10,000. Then once you have the value of DPMO, then you would remember that there was a table which was showing, which was relating the sigma level and the DPMO. So 10,000 DPMO can be equated to a sigma level. So it will be somewhere around 2.3 or 2.4. So once you calculate the DPMO this way, we will be able to calculate the sigma level. So some other cases, we can also find the yields. So the definition for the yield, again there is going to be a different definitions for the terminology yield. So traditionally, the yield was defined as the total good output divided by the total inputs. So traditionally, if you see the traditional yield, so Y is equal to YT, that is a traditional yield was equal to number of good products divided by number of inputs. Suppose assume that you are having a three-step process. So you are giving 100 numbers as an input to the first process. It is a three-step process. And the last process was giving 90 products as a good product. Then according to the traditional yield, YT is equal to 90 divided by 100. Is equal to 0.9, or we can say it is a 90% is the yield. But actually what may happen is in the process A, process B, process C. So these are the three processes. But once you do a micro level analysis, you may find that out of this 100, maybe 5 products were totally rejected and 5 products were reworked. So the yield at this particular process was 95 divided by 100, and here again 3 is rejected and maybe 2 products are being reworked. So the yield at this particular stage is a rejection. So the yield is 95 divided by yield is 97 divided by 100, and again here again you assume that there were 2 products which are rejected and 10 products which are reworked. So if you see the rejections at this particular stage was only 90%. 5 were totally rejected and 5 were taken for rework. So if you say the YA yield was only 90%, that is 90 divided by 100. So out of this, 5 were reworked and used, and then 5 were rejected. And again, if you see the second process, you assume that 7 are reworked and 3 are rejected fully, then YB, that yield at process B, is equal to again 90 by 100. And again, if you see the process 3, 8 are reworked and 2 are rejected, so YC is equal to also 90 divided by 100. But if you see the overall yield as measured by the traditional yield, since you are going to reject only 5 plus 3 plus 2, that is equal to 10 is the total rejection, then you will say that your the first time yield was 90%, whereas actually the yield at the individual stages was only 90%, because there was amount of rework. So this amount of rework was there in the process. So in the whenever we are talking about the first time yield, so whenever you are talking about the first time yield, we are trying to find out what is the yield at the first stage, which were first time write. So in that case, if you are trying to find out what is the first time yield, we also call that as a rolled throughput yield. So first time yield or rolled throughput yield, we calculate by multiplying the individual yields, that is YA into YB into YC. That is equal to 0.9 into 0.9 into 0.9. That is equal to 0.729. So here we find that according to traditional yield, it was 0.9, whereas the first time yield was, or the rolled throughput yield was only 73%. So that means around 17% was the rework. So this 17% rework is not captured in the traditional yield, whereas that is captured in the rolled throughput yield. So this rework, we call that as a hidden factory. So this is where most of our efforts, time and efforts are being spent in order to rectify these reworks. So calculating the rolled throughput yield will help you to identify the hidden factory, and then any problems can be taken up as a Six Sigma project. So that is the purpose of calculating the rolled throughput yield. So here we have seen first time, first pass yield is the first time yield, that is the unit pass divided by units inputs for the first time. So whatever the goods which are passed for the first time without any rework, we call that as a first pass yield. And in order to calculate the rolled throughput yield for a process having multiple processes, we calculate by multiplying the yield of the individual sub-processes. And the cycle time, and the cycle time can be calculated as 1 divided by the throughput rate. So that means if on an average you are producing 60 insurance policies every hour, 60 policies every hour, then cycle time is equal to 1 divided by 60 into 60 seconds, that is 1 per second. So that means we should get the insurance policies at the rate of 1 insurance policy per hour. We call that as a cycle time. So in this session, we have learnt about the definition of a process, the critical to quality characteristics CTQ, the cost of poor quality COPQ, the Pareto analysis or the 80-20 rule, and the basic Six Sigma metrics. So one thing, what very important thing you have to learn here is the critical to quality characteristics CTQ, or initially we talked about the CTX, is not limited only to any quality parameters like defects or defectives. So the CTX can be, we can call that either as a CTP, is a critical to process. It can be a CTD, that is a critical to delivery. It can be COQ, there's a cost of quality. It can be CTS, critical to safety. Or it can be CTQ, critical to any of the quality parameters. So any of this metric can be taken up as a metric for improvement in a Six Sigma process. So that is a summary of this particular session.